Good morning, everyone. For our first one, we're going to turn back to Mark chapter 5. And we're going to go right after where we had left off previously in verse 21. Of Mark 5. All right. Now, this passage that we have here in Mark chapter 5, this takes place just following Christ's exorcism of that Gadarene demoniac we had seen in the first part of Mark 5 there. So he's down on that southeast coast of the Sea of Galilee, and he gets back in the ship and he travels back over to Capernaum. And here in this the rest of Mark 5 that we see here, we have two stories that are seemingly intertwined together. We have story A that starts going, and then story B kind of seems like it just jumps in there and interrupts, and then we get back to story A again after that. But knowing our Lord and how he operates, we know that this is, of course, no interruption. Christ was installed by this, and as soon as I start going, if you started reading it, you'll know this passage, probably many of you. It's not that he couldn't get to Jairus' daughter in time because he was stalled by this woman with the issue of blood. He does this intentionally to teach us something. Remember, he's God Almighty. He rules the whole universe from ever, forever. So let's dive into our text here. Mark 5:21, we see Jairus coming here with a request, a true prayer for his daughter. Mark 5:21, and when Jesus was passed over again by the ship unto the other side, much people gathered unto him, and he was nigh unto the sea. And behold, there cometh one of the rulers of the synagogue, Jairus by name. And when he saw him, he fell at his feet and besought him greatly, saying, My little daughter lieth at the point of death. I pray thee, come and lay thy hands on her, that she may be healed, and she shall live. And Jesus went with him, and much people followed him and thronged him. Now, Jairus, he came here deliberately, fervently. You can read the same account, from some of the other Gospels. This man came desperate. He was deliberate and fervent, begging the Lord to the point to where he's almost kind of getting on your nerves a little bit. Like, yes, I hear you. I get this. I understand. Because this was very personal for him. His little Kezia, his little Juniper Ruth, his little Caroline, his little Sarah or Chloe, she was gasping on her final breaths back at his house, and she didn't have much longer to live. So when he came to him, he came and was insisting strongly because this was a very personal matter for him. And I'm certainly no expert on prayer, but this much is certain. Prayer is real. When we come to God, as this man Jairus did, coming first to Christ specifically, taking our prayers directly to him. When we present our needs before him, when we acknowledge and ask him to help as only he can, knowing that no one else can do this for me. I can't do this in myself. No one else can help me. Only you can do this, Christ. And then trusting 100% that he has the power to do it. And if he wants to do it, he will. And our blessed Redeemer, he is a very gracious Lord. He hears Jairus' prayer and he follows him. He goes with him. And the condition that we have here, just a quick note on this. It says he's one of the rulers of the synagogues. He's a pretty high status in the community. But we can clearly see that no matter how rich or poor, whatever your status is in society, nobody is immune from sicknesses and mortality. Death and sicknesses touch everyone. And nobody, regardless of your status, is immune from all the different emotions and feelings that anybody else might be. And so he starts to go along with him here, and then we kind of have this other story seem to just interject itself in there. In Mark 5, verse 25, we read, And a certain woman, which had an issue of blood 12 years, God always has a purpose for everything he does. And this seemingly unplanned interruption is, of course, no interruption at all. But this is to accomplish a purpose that he has set forth. And a certain woman, which had an issue of blood 12 years, and had suffered many things of many physicians, and had spent all that she had and was nothing bettered, but rather grew worse. And when she had heard of Jesus, came in the press behind and touched his garment, for she said, "If I may but touch his clothes, I shall be made whole." And straightway the fountain of her blood was dried up, and she felt in her body that she was healed of that plague. And Jesus, immediately knowing in himself what virtue had gone out of him, turned him about in the press and said, "Who touched my clothes?" And the disciples said unto him, "Thou seest the multitude thronging thee, and sayest thou, Who touched me?" And he looked round about to see her that had done this thing. But the woman, fearing and trembling, knowing what was done in her, came and fell down before him, and told him all the truth. And he said unto her, "Daughter, thy faith hath made thee whole. Go in peace, and be whole of thy plague." Now, I want us to just go back and look at Leviticus, so we can see the law here, why it specifically talks about her having this issue of blood, so we can kind of understand the situation that this woman was in. This isn't just a physical health problem. It, of course, is a very big physical health problem, but that's not the only thing going on here. So turn to Leviticus 15, verse 25. While you're turning there, I'm going to read up from a few verses beforehand. "And if a woman have an issue, and her issue in her flesh be blood, she shall be put apart 7 days. And whosoever touches her shall be unclean until the evening, and everything that she lies upon in her separation shall be unclean. Everything also that she sits upon shall be unclean. And whosoever touches her bed shall wash his clothes and bathe himself in water and will be unclean until the evening. And whosoever touches anything that she sits on shall wash his clothes and bathe himself in water and be unclean until the evening. And if it be on her bed or anything whereon she sits, and when he touches it, he shall be unclean until the evening. And if any man lie with her at all, and her flowers be upon him, he shall be unclean 7 days, and all the bed whereon he lieth shall be unclean." So this, they're talking of a woman's normal menstrual period. It's not like we don't have anything that we can really relate to this in our day. I mean, you have a regular time of the month, you have a pat, you take care of it, and you just go about your normal life. It doesn't impact you socially, legally. There's no implications there with that. But in God's law, this made you unclean. And so for that time, anything you touched, your bed, the chair you sat on, if I came in contact with anything, I'm unclean now. There's much bigger implications here. And then verse 25, so this is when it goes beyond just your normal monthly cycle. "And if a woman have an issue of her blood many days out of the time of her separation, or if it runs beyond the time of her separation, all the days of the issue of her uncleanness shall be as the days of her separation. She shall be unclean." So whether that goes for 2 extra days, or 2 extra weeks, or 2 extra years, or 12 extra years like this woman, all those same rules still apply. "And whosoever touches those things shall be unclean, and shall wash his clothes and bathe himself in water and be unclean until the evening. But if she be cleansed of her issue, then shall she number to herself 7 days. And after that she shall be clean. And on the 8th day shall take unto her 2 turtles or 2 young pigeons and bring them to the priest to the door of the tabernacle of the congregation. And the priest shall offer the one for a sin offering and the other for a burnt offering. And the priest shall make an atonement for her before the Lord for issue of her uncleanness. Thus shall ye separate the children of Israel from their uncleanness, that they die not in their uncleanness. When they defile my tabernacle that is among them, this is the law of him that has an issue, and of him whose seed goes from him, and is defiled therewith, and of her that is sick of her flowers, and of him that hath an issue of the man, and of the woman, and of him that lieth with her that is unclean." So, before God's law, this woman, she didn't just wear a pad and then go about her day and everything was normal. No. Anything and everything she touched became unclean. And anyone and everyone who came in contact with her or even touched the things she just touched also became unclean. And this ought to just, in this law alone, show us there's no way we are ever going to keep God's law. This woman here We had this issue of blood. She's there crawling through the crowds of people. How many of those people do you think, one, even realized, maybe some of them recognized her, she's had this for 12 years, but most of them probably had no idea of her crawling through those things and all those people she touched, unclean, 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 unclean. Now, there's, of course, you know, no direct relationship that we can appreciate, you know, the gravity of her situation in our society today. We can read about her being a social pariah and understand these things sort of, but we have difficulty understanding the legal implications and the societal implications of this. So to kind of put it in a perspective, some of you, probably most commonly in childbirth, not to call anyone out, but Sarah, I know for a fact, and I'm sure some of you others, have had hemorrhages and other things that have happened in the past. And imagine having something like that, but it goes on for 12 years. Except in this society, it's socially completely unacceptable. You're defiled, you're unclean. It's effectively as being illegal to have that. And being so, no one can come in contact with you. So obviously you get terminated from your job. You lose your health benefits. You spend all the money that you have trying to do medical tests and all these medications and treatments. Nothing helps you. Nothing makes anything better. But it doesn't even just leave you at a net zero. It says she was actually made worse by all of these things. So all of these things actually make the hemorrhaging even worse than it was beforehand. I mean, people talk about being anemic, bleeding like this, hemorrhaging for 12 years, especially considering, you know, the medical system and nutrition resources they had in that day. Just complete, just utter, just depleted state of being. I mean, you picture yourself. We're like, Carol, where were you 12 years ago? Think of what you were doing, what you were wearing, all those things. Now imagine being in that place with whatever clothes you have, and then from then till now, being homeless, having no money, whatever clothes you've got left, just completely depleted, no house, nothing. And 12 years later today, you're still in that exact same state. This kind of gives you an understanding of what this sad, sad woman's life was like. And there are eight characteristics about this woman that I want us to look at. First, of course, she was depleted. It says she owned nothing. She didn't even have a phone anymore. She had no money, couldn't even buy something off the dollar menu. Completely depleted of all of her resources. She was defiled. She seemed to be cursed, as we would say, with this horrible disease that just left her bleeding over a decade. Just horrible, horribly defiled and unable to sleep, unable to do anything, and just unclean before the law. She was deceived. She was promised many things by many doctors, but none of them worked. They told her, oh, this will work this time, and just none of it ever worked. She was very, very disappointed. After all these years and having all these expectations set that, okay, this is going to work, and then it doesn't. Oh, this is going to work, and then it doesn't. Oh, this is going to find out the root, and then it doesn't. Just the constant disappointment for year after year after year. And she was desperate. I mean, you can only be a bleeding beggar for so long. Your iron's going to deplete. Your immune system will deteriorate. You can only do that for so long before you will die. But we know that if you're the Lord's, it doesn't matter what state you put yourself in or what state he puts you in. If you're the Lord's, he will preserve you until his time. And sadly, just as her physical condition was demonstrated all of these things. Sadly, this is the same case for most people in most places today with regards to their eternal souls. Many go seeking all the different doctors they are around here. They go up to North Jersey and look for Mr. Doctor Decision, who tells them, if you just decide, make a decision for Jesus, you'll be saved. But that doesn't work. They keep bleeding. So they travel upstate to New York to Dr. Be Good, and he tells you all you have to do is you just have to reform your life. And then you'll be saved. That doesn't work either. So they go all the way up to Maine, where they hear about this Dr. Freewill, and he tells you all you've got to do is you just have to will away this issue of blood. You just will away the sin, and you'll be saved. That doesn't work either. So you travel all the way over to the other coast, to Washington, where you have Dr. Wright Church, and he lets you know the whole problem, the reason none of this worked was because you weren't in the right church. You got to get to the right church, the right congregation of people. and that doesn't work either. So then you travel down to Southern California, where you find Dr. Excitement, who tells you, we're going to speak in tongues, and we're going to do all these miracles, and jump up and down, we're going to get God's attention, and we're going to heal you. And that doesn't work either. And you're really, really desperate at this point. You hear this cutting-edge doctor over in Europe, so you fly over to Europe to Dr. Emotion, who tells you, all you have to do to be cleansed is, if you look really, really deep within yourself, and you feel really sorry, and you repent of your sins, you'll be saved. And that doesn't work either. And this woman, she maxed out every credit card, she took out every loan, she mortgaged everything she once had, and nothing helped her. Not only did none of these doctors help her, they actually put her in a worse state than she was had she not done anything at all. So what does she do? There are three more characteristics of those eight about this woman. First, we're told in verse 25 that she was a certain woman. This woman was distinct. She wasn't just any woman. She was a certain woman. How marvelous is it that God has chosen a certain people for whom to spend eternity with, a certain people for whom his son bled and died, a certain people to whom he sends his spirit to do a work of grace in their hearts. How marvelous is that? She was determined. Being a certain woman, Christ had touched her in her heart. And in doing so, she was determined to touch the healer, the great physician, determined to be healed and saved. We heard in that verse there, forget which verse it is, but it says that she had heard of Jesus. Nothing happens except first hearing of our Lord and Redeemer. And lastly, she was delivered. Christ knew all this, of course. And so when she came and touched him, it says that virtue went out and she was healed and cleansed. And she was delivered of this ailment. But Christ here, he didn't just do this in some quiet alleyway and let her, you know, touch him and get away with it. He was determined to make a scene about it. Let's read it together. Mark 5:29. And straightway, after she touched him, straightway the fountain of her blood was dried up, and she felt in her body that she was healed of that plague. Now, verse 30, we read, and Jesus, immediately knowing in himself that virtue had gone out of him, turned about in the press and said, who touched my clothes? She comes here determined because the Lord had touched her in her heart first. If I can just, I'll be healed. And so she did it, and the Lord healed her. And Christ goes, who touched me? Remember, he's going with Jairus here and his daughter. There's all this crowd of people that are thronging about, trying to get through the crowds to the place there. And he says, who touched me? And his disciples say, thou seest the multitude thronging thee and say, who touched me? They answer him basically the same way they did in Mark 4 when they were on the storm there. They're crawling through there. Are you joking right now? Really? You want to know who touched you? I can name 500 people who touched you. Where do you want me to start? Like this, just this sarcastic, I mean, I would imagine in my own sin, I would probably answer a very similar way if I saw someone ask me a question like this. Like, what do you mean, who touched you? But our Lord, just like we saw in Mark 4, when they were on those troubled seas in Galilee, he is a very, very patient Lord. He doesn't entertain it or go back bickering and fighting with them. He just moves along. It says, verse 32, and he looked round about to see her that had done this thing. But the woman, fearing and trembling, knowing what was done in her, came and fell down before him and told him all the truth. Christ touched her heart, and she came down and fell before him. We see here, salvation is personal. There's all these people, I'm sure lots of them had cold, flu, sicknesses, whatever. There's hundreds and hundreds of people, all of them crowding around him, touching him, and only one person is healed. This is a very personal thing between Christ and just the one person that he came to save. There's no such thing as group salvation. The state of your soul is between just you and God. And when Christ touches your heart for the first time, you'll tell the truth. You won't be truthful before that time, but once he touches you and his virtue flows into you, your fatal bleeding, that fatal condition you have that will destroy you, will be dried up, And for the first time, you'll speak to God honestly as who you really are. So I ask you, do you have a true understanding of how defiled and unclean you are? Just like we saw earlier in the same chapter here, do you have a true understanding of how demon-possessed you are? Christ, he didn't let this thing go unseen in a dark alleyway. He made a very public spectacle of it. And the reason he made a public spectacle of this is because all those people who would come to Christ, all those who he draws to him that would identify with him, he will make it so that you must do so publicly. That's what we have believers' baptism for. That's why we worship and gather together to meet. Those who will identify with him, he will see to it that we do so publicly. And then we see Christ's first personal, audible word to her. He spoke to her in her heart. She heard of him. But here we see the first words that he says as a human to her. Mark 5:34, he says, "Daughter, thy faith hath made thee whole. Go in peace, and also be whole of thy plague." Christ addresses her as the child of God that she is. He calls her daughter. And her faith here, it didn't sit idly by and wait for Christ to come to whatever cardboard box she was living out of. No, it got her to get up and go find Christ and crawl through the crowd at great peril. If people had found out how unclean she was and the laws she was breaking, she would have been cast out. But that didn't matter because she needed to get to the Savior. She needed to get to the great physician to touch him because he was drawing her to him. And for that, Christ, he didn't just make her whole in spirit. He says, "Daughter, thy faith hath made thee whole." But he did something also super gracious and just benevolent. He also cleansed her of this physical plague too. The spiritual always precedes the physical. And so just like we saw previously outside Gadara, where we have another instance where if you're just reading through it quickly, you're just glancing over it, you see this gathering demoniac come charging at Christ. Why? So that way he could get himself exorcised, so that way he could get these demons cast out. Here you have this woman who, on the face of it, just seems like she's coming to Christ, she made the decision, she's running to him, or crawling to him, just to touch him to be saved. But we know that your works and your ability won't do this. You cannot come to Christ except Christ first draw you. Spurgeon put it in a very eloquent way. He made this statement, which I'm going to read the quote to you, explaining this in a very good way that we can understand. He writes, "A needle will move toward a magnet once a magnet has moved near to it. Our heart manifests a sweet willingness toward salvation and holiness when the great and glorious goodwill of the Lord operates upon it. It is ours to run to Jesus as if all the runnings were ours. But the secret truth is that the Lord runs to us. And this is the very heart of the business." So this part of the passage concludes, this story B that just kind of seemed to interject itself into story A. But story A is still happening. Remember, the whole point of this was Jairus came to Christ and said, "My daughter is dying. Chloe is at home. She's going to die." Ravi, I'm sure you can relate to this very, very well. While all this is happening, and Jairus is here, he's with the Lord, they're traveling to his house, on a scale of 1 to 10, how anxious do you think he was while Christ stopped to take care of this woman, while he stopped to cleanse Carol of her issue of blood? Christ wasn't here just, you know, moving, jogging along, "Oh, this woman touched me, I don't have time to deal with this, we got to get there in time so I can save her." That's not what he did. They were going along there with the throng of people, and she touched him. "Whoa, everyone stop, somebody touched me," and made a whole scene and stopped everything. Meanwhile, Jairus' daughter is still at home dying. She doesn't have much longer to live. Jairus, though, he demonstrated faith that, frankly, I wish I had. I'm sure he was thinking the whole time of his daughter. There's no way he couldn't have been thinking of his daughter. But he waited patiently on the Lord to answer his prayer in the timing that the Lord saw fit. And he didn't try to interject, and he didn't try to interrupt, but he just waited patiently for the Lord. The Lord went with him. He said he's going to do it. "All right, I trust you, Lord. I'll wait." The Lord, sometimes, rarely though, does he answer our prayers altogether immediately. He does sometimes, but that is not often the case. Mark 5:35, we read, "While he yet spake, there came from the ruler of the synagogue's house certain which said, Thy daughter is dead. Why troublest thou the master any further?" This person, one, they were very blunt. But how sad is that? They weren't fast enough. Had they not been delayed by the dealings of this woman with the issue of blood, Christ could have been there in time, and he might have been able to save that little girl the same way he was able to save this woman. What makes that woman's life more valuable than his little girl's life? Why is Carol's life more valuable than Chloe's? They were out there trying to help. He was trying to find help for his daughter. And in doing so, one, he didn't get there in time. He couldn't get that help. And two, he didn't even get to say goodbye to his daughter before she died. But it is a glorious thing that the Lord does not do things our way. Because just like we got a little bit of a glimpse with the Gadarene demoniac at the end when the Gadarene said, "Lord, I want to go with you. Take me with you on the ship." And he said, "No, you're going to stay here." Same thing with Jairus. Our Lord's way of doing things is far more magnificent than anything we ever would have expected or anything that we would have planned. So let's keep reading there in verse 36. As soon as Jesus heard the word that was spoken, he said unto the ruler of the synagogue, this is the whole gospel right here. This is all the hope, compassion, peace, and comfort we have. He said to the ruler of the synagogue, be not afraid, only believe. That's all you have to do. Be not afraid, only believe. And he suffered no man to follow him, except for these three disciples, Peter and James and John, the brother of James. And he came to the house of the ruler of the synagogue and sees the tumult and them that wept and wailed greatly. Remember, this guy, he's a ruler of the synagogue. He's fairly high up in society. I'm sure he has lots of friends and family and neighbors. She's sick. They hear of this great physician. Everybody come here. We got to be here. This is family time. We need to see her and be here with her. We have this great physician coming. I know he's going to save her. Everybody come watch this. And the daughter dies. And this is, she's so obviously dead. Just lying there, cold, lifeless. All the color has left her. If you read Luke's account, it even says the spirit has left her body. She's not sleeping. She's not in some near like coma or other state. She's dead, and it's very obvious. And they get there, and they are weeping and wailing greatly. And he comes in and says unto them, why do you make all this ado? What's all this hubbub about? Why are you weeping? The damsel's not dead, but she's sleeping. And they laughed him to scorn. She is so obviously dead. Christ, how could you come here and make such an insensitive, or maybe it's not insensitive, maybe you're just blind and you can't see things for what they really are. She's dead. Why would you say something like that? This is not the time and the place to be making comments like that. This is their dead daughter. They laughed him to scorn, but when he had put them all out, very similar to how he dealt with his disciples and on the ships and the sea. He deals with this over and over and over again. They do all these just constant remarks that are just stupid, talking out of your you-know-what remarks. Like the disciples and these people here, why are you laughing at him to scorn? They think they know better. You think you know more than Christ. You know nothing. But he doesn't go back and forth arguing with them. He just, all right, you guys get out. And then he takes Jairus, the father, and the mother of the damsel, and those three disciples that were with him, and they enter into the room where the damsel is lying. Now, we know Christ, he's God. He knew all this ahead of time. He does all things on purpose for the good of his people and for the glory of his name. Jairus and his wife, they were devastated. Horribly, horribly devastated. Christ here, he seems to be making just an absurd and distasteful remark, as though he was just completely oblivious to reality. And that's why they laughed at him. I don't know if Jairus and the mother did, perhaps not, but at least the people that were there weeping and whatnot did. But our Christ, our Lord, our Savior, being the gracious and patient Lord that he was, he just continued on his business, permitting only those five people to enter into the room where she was sleeping. And then we see this miracle happen. Let's read it in verse 41. And he took the damsel by the hand and said unto her, Talitha kumai, which is being interpreted, Damsel, I say unto thee, arise. And immediately, straightway, the damsel pops up and she starts walking around. And Mark here adds this little bit of information just so we know that she's of the age, and also for another reason too. She gets up and she starts walking around because she's a little 12-year-old girl. Interesting. That woman with the issue of the blood had that issue for 12 years too. And they were astonished with a great astonishment. I mean, we can read about it and go, oh yeah, he saved someone who raised them from the dead. Yeah. But we've never been at an open casket funeral and seen someone who was obviously dead just pop up and start walking around. They were astonished with a great astonishment. And he charged them straightly that no man should know it. That's kind of interesting. Seems to be the opposite of what he just did with the woman with the issue of blood. And commanded that something be given to her to eat. What a blessed thing he did physically for this little girl, raising her from the dead. And what a blessed foreshadowing this is of things to come. Christ, he came down to earth from holy heaven to die and save his certain people from their sins. He did it, and then he returned to heaven's glory. And there will be a day at a time and an hour when nobody knows, and he's going to return, and all the sleeping children of the Lord will be raised incorruptible, and those who are still living will be changed in the twinkling of an eye. Christ here, he took her by the hand, and he commanded her to rise. And she did. We saw, if you remember back in Mark 3 with the lame man that they brought, no sickness is too sick for God to heal. Then we saw Mark 4, the storms on the sea, the forces of nature, no power of this planet, no nature, Mother Nature as many people call it, are too strong for God to overcome. Then in the beginning of Mark 5, not even the devils of hell are too powerful for Christ to rule over. And here we see, not even death itself, the king of terrors, can stop God. Death is real, but God is more powerful. In Luke's account of the resurrection of this little girl, he notes that her spirit returns to her. The mocking and the laughing at Christ by all the mourners and whoever was there, along with Luke's account, help give us a strong understanding of how obviously dead this girl was. That she wasn't just in a coma or some deep sleeping, near-death sort of state. She was dead. But when Christ said, rise and get up, her spirit returned to her, and she rose and stood up. When God commands something, all things that he commands obey straight away, immediately, and without delay. And in this final verse here, we have two things here in this final verse. First, he commands that they don't tell this to anybody. It seems to be a direct contradiction to what he just did a couple of verses back with the woman, the issue of blood, where he said, stop, everybody look, and made a whole scene out of it. Now he's saying, you don't tell a word of this to anybody. But we do know, obviously, based off of all of the accounts there, that everybody knew that this girl was dead. There was no doubt in anybody's minds. All the friends, all the neighbors, the coworkers, colleagues, family, everybody was there. Everybody knew for a fact that this girl was dead. That's why they laughed him to scorn. And so this girl, now being resurrected from the dead, she's a little 12-year-old girl, she's going to go back to school and go to the market and go weed the garden and go back doing all the things that she would been doing beforehand. And they're going to see her and they're going to be astonished with a great astonishment. He said he sent them all outside the house. They're all waiting out there. She's going to get up, and when she goes to walk out, oh, I got to go take the weeds care in the garden. She was dead. This command was given to avoid any arguing or any debate over whether or not this thing really happened. And rather than talk about it, Christ commanded, let the actions speak louder than words. This little girl resuming her life, when everybody knew that she was dead, is going to speak volumes more than the accounts of a couple eyewitnesses ever could. And what we see here, just like we saw previously in Mark, is that not only our great Lord and Redeemer, not only is he all-powerful and able to save Anybody, no matter what the situation is, no matter how sick, how dead, how possessed, it doesn't matter. You come to Christ, he can save you. That no matter how powerful he is also a thoroughly compassionate Savior, one who knows all our feelings and can sympathize with us completely, as the Hebrew writer tells us. That no matter how lame you may be, no matter how bad the storms around you may be raging, no matter how possessed of demons you may be, no matter how incurable your disease is, no matter how dead in sin you are, nothing is too hard for the Lord, and no one is beyond his ability to save. And then after all that, he commands that some food be brought to this little girl. After we are all raised to life, he provides us with the living bread for our living souls, in the preaching of the gospel and fellowshipping with each other in the assembly of ourselves. He does this great work, but he still so tenderly cares for this little girl that says, hey, you go get her something to eat. She's hungry. And so just a few closing remarks on these two females here. One, as I just mentioned, having been saved from certain death, either death that was going to happen very, very soon as the woman with the issue of blood, or the death of this little girl who had already died. Both of these people were very tenderly spoken to and cared for by our Lord. He called the one daughter, and the other he commanded some food be brought to her. He is a very tender and gracious great physician. Next, that number 12. The Hebrew year was divided into 12 months, and the day into 12 hours. Israel had 12 sons. There were 12 tribes of Israel. Christ chose 12 apostles. 12 is therefore linked with the elective purposes of God. These two females, the woman who had the issue of blood for 12 years and this little 12-year-old girl who had died, are both great pictures for us of what God does for his elect, of those he came here to save, that despite all their best efforts, despite all the doctors and things they tried, were not able to save themselves, but he was able to save them. Then we saw that this first woman, the woman with the issue of blood, he made a spectacle of that miracle, because those who will be identified with Christ must do so publicly. And lastly, for this little girl, he made this miracle a private thing. Because there's not going to be any discussions or arguments on whether or not someone is regenerated. The resurrection, there's not going to be any arguments either whether or not a believer is saved or regenerated. That's not for us to discuss. If they're alive, you'll see them walking around. Now go feed them with the living bread. Let's pray. Lord, we are so thankful for all the things you've come here and provided for us, and all the times you try our patience. Lord, please give us that patience, that trust and faith like you gave Jairus, to present our problems before you and then wait wholly trusting for you to do them. Lord, draw us to you like you drew this woman with the issue of blood, that if we could just get to you, we know you can make all things better. Lord, please keep us always remembering of your compassion and how we ought to be compassionate to each other. Thank you so much for all these things you do for us. And in our Redeemer, your beloved Son's name we pray. Amen.
Christ has done it all, though feeble I'll not fall. sinner's cheek.